Right, so maybe we'll start now. There may be others who will join us, but
sure.
So thanks to all the attendees who have joined us as of now. Just to introduce myself, my name is Viswanathan. I'm a faculty member in IIMU Udaipur, and I'm also a member of the programs committee, which oversees the conduct of various academic programs in the institute, including the one-year MBA in Global Supply Chain Management, which is probably what you would all be interested in. And joining us today with me is Koshika. She's from the first batch of this program from IIM Udaipur, and like many of our alumni, she's been very closely engaged with the institute and contributes a lot to the institute and the program. And she's been kind enough to join us today. So, Koshika, if you could introduce yourself.
Sure. Thank you, Professor. So, essentially, as sir mentioned, I was part of the first batch that graduated from IIM Udaipur for this program, and currently I'm part of a company called IntegriChain, and we are in the data analytics and data science space, specifically in the US healthcare and life sciences. And I've been with this company for the past 6 years. So yeah, all good so far. And just a quick one-liner as well. So before joining Udaipur course, I was part of manufacturing. So did manufacturing for 6 years, took a break for about 3 odd years, joined the GSCM course, and now again, I'm with this company again for the past 6 years. It has been an amazing journey so far. Thank you.
Thanks, Koshika. So what I'll do is I'll just start off with a very brief presentation, which kind of sets the tone for this and introduces the program. Then after that, we'll take questions. Those who have questions, if you could put it into the Q&A window and not the chat window, sometimes that happens. So I'll just... Right. I hope the screen is visible. So we are, the topic of the discussion is the one-year MBA on Global Supply Chain Management, and so this is a 12-month program, okay, which would start in April 2020 and get over by March 2021, and it focuses on global supply chain management. It is intended to for people who already have work experience, so a minimum of 3 years of work experience is a requirement for this program. We believe that given the condensed time frame of the program, and also the fact that it specializes in a particular field, it'd be of a lot more value to people who have experience, some amount of work experience already. And the program offers two tracks, one of which is a dual degree track, and I'll get into that in a little more detail. So the first option that one has is the dual degree program, where you end up getting an MBA in Global Supply Chain Management from IIM Udaipur, and also a master MS from Purdue University. So the way this program is structured is for about 4 months, a little more than 4 months, all the students come to IIM Udaipur and go through various courses which take you through the basics of management, the fundamentals of management. So not necessarily supply chain management, but all areas of management, which includes finance, marketing, operations, HR, economics. So all the basics that a manager requires. And this is a fairly rigorous module. And given that it's a supply chain management program, there would be a little bit more of focus on supply chain management and operations management during this time. But it's fundamentally aimed to equip you with the basic management fundamentals. After that, starting around sometime in August 2020, the students who opt for this option would move to Purdue University, the Kranitz School of Management, which is one of the foremost in the supply chain management space. And there you would undergo, you would take up certain courses which focus on supply chain management in the global context, and also a set of electives from among those that Kranitz School offers. So you basically spend one semester in Purdue. At the end of which, around the second half of December, you return to IIMU Udaipur and do the third module, where you take up certain electives in IIMU Udaipur. And so till March, you take up these electives, which may be focused on supply chain management or other areas of business management. So that's how the program is structured over 12 months in three modules, giving you a breadth of management and a depth of understanding in the supply chain management space. The other option that you have is of doing the entire program from IIMU Udaipur itself. So you would get the MBA in Global Supply Chain Management from IIMU Udaipur. And here the way it is different is that the second module, which in option one you would go to Purdue for, in option two you would stay on in IIMU Udaipur, and similar courses would be conducted in IIMU Udaipur. So there would be a deep dive into supply chain management, and there would be electives that you can take up in other business management areas during this time. And there would also be an opportunity for some exposure to international business. So, but overall, it is structured the same way. It's about over the same period of time as the first option. And as you may be familiar already, the eligibility criteria for option one is that you should have 16 years of education. With a bachelor's degree in any discipline, whereas option two requires you to have 15 years of education. So that's the difference in the requirements. You have to have a valid GRE or GMAT score at the time of application, and by February 2020, you should have 36 months of work experience. Those are the eligibility criteria, and this program has been going on now for 6 years plus, and it's established itself as a unique program in this field. And IIMU Udaipur has itself started in 2011. And within a short span of less than a decade, we believe we have made considerable progress. We were the youngest institute in the country to get AACSB accreditation. We are the youngest institute in the world to feature in the Financial Times Masters in Management rankings. We believe we have made a lot of progress in this time, and we are working hard to keep the momentum going. So with that background, I'll switch back to taking questions. There are some questions that we have received. I'll have a look at that and start answering. There are many details which are available on the IIMU Udaipur website. We will some of you may have gone through that. If not, I'd urge you to go through that. So the first question is a very specific one. It is, how many seats are available in the 2020 batch? Okay, So Koshika, I'll take that question. So far this program has been generally it's been about 20 students per batch, but this year we're looking at increasing that intake also because this is the first time that we are also offering the IIM Udaipur only option, right? So option one and option two. Till last year it was only option one which was an offer. So we are looking at increasing the intake. We do not have a specific upper limit saying, you know, which is somewhat flexible, but up to about 40 students is probably okay, but you know, if it's a little less or a little more, it's not that we're very worked up about that. Okay, so Kalyan, I hope that answers your question. Okay, if you all hear some music in the background, that's because the students just completed their midterm exams in one of the programs and they're very happy about it. Right. Okay, so there's a question from an anonymous attendee who says, what if I have work experience in the IT sector, which is not related to operations or supply chain, and I want to shift my career? So will IIM Udaipur consider someone like this? So I'll take that first and then Koshika maybe could add to that. Yes, we do consider candidates who do not have a background in operations or supply chain management. And in fact, a good number of our students for this program do not have such a background. So, and a good number of our students do come from the IT sector as well. And your having an IT background has its own value. Right? So because any classroom that we have here has people from varied backgrounds, both in terms of their experience, their education, their life experiences, and that's very valuable in an MBA program. To your very specific question of whether you'd be considered having IT experience, yes, you would be considered. Koshika, would you want to add to that?
Sure. So, sorry, you've already covered the first part of it, essentially speaking. So, the only thing I would want to add for this attendee is that when you look at IT, right now, if you look at it, everything is predominantly, you can't run away from technology. So, when we say supply chain or operations, there's a lot of blend that's happening in technology where we say IT-based, IT-enabled supply chain. There are a lot of activities on that front happening, but you know, there are a lot of companies who have product suites. If you look at it, technology companies that have product offerings that are supply chain offerings. So I'm part of one of such companies. So I can say that when it comes to it, it's a very good merge that you look at it in the current scenario, the way businesses are growing and want to grow.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Sure.
So the next one, next question is from Mayur, and it is, say you are a marine engineer with 4 years of work experience looking to move from operations on ships to operations on land. And so you're saying that the fee is different for the two programs. For purpose of calculating ROI, can we expect Purdue students to get a higher salary package compared to students who have done the entire program in IIM Udaipur? It's a tough one. So thanks, Mayur, for asking that question. And to the first one about your being a marine engineer and so on, we actually, for some interesting reason, we do tend to get marine engineers in almost every batch that we have here, we've had here. Regarding whether people who take option one versus option two, there would be a differential in salary that they get. I'm afraid I wouldn't have very, I wouldn't have data at all because this is the first time that we are offering option two, right? So then I can only hazard some, an opinion on this. The way I look at it, there are companies which are looking for certain training in their employees, right? So there may be those who are looking for the global exposure which the Purdue experience brings. And there may be others who are not so particular about that. Whether that would translate into a higher salary is a little difficult to say. Unless we get people who are exactly the same in all respects, except that one has gone to Purdue and the other has not, it's a little difficult to make out that difference. So I'm not immediately able to give you a very precise answer on this. Would you have any thoughts, Koshika?
Sure. So essentially, when any company is looking for a candidate, when they want to hire someone, they're looking at an entire package. So when we say Purdue versus IIM Udaipur, as far as the learning goes, knowledge, studies, academics, it's pretty much the same. The differentiating factor is that you're getting an international exposure. So that's something when you come across in an interview, it solely depends on the individual, how you're able to drive that interview to bring up the advantage of Purdue that you've brought in, that you've learned or gained from the exposure that you've had there, the way you interact with people, the way you are able. And then moreover, even if you get, when you join a company, further as you grow, it purely depends on that individual's capability and how you're able to project yourself, essentially speaking. So from a company's standpoint, they're not differentiating between Purdue and IIM Udaipur, unless and until, as a professor said, that they are looking for a candidate who they probably want to place abroad in the US, then yes, there's a difference. They're looking for something else.
Thanks. Yeah. And just to clarify on that, the placements actually happen in India, from out of IIM Udaipur. It's difficult to get placed from Purdue for various reasons, including visas and other issues. So the expectation of placement should be out of IIM Udaipur. I hope that answers your question, Mayur. If you have anything more, you could ask a supplementary. There's another question from Manishankar, which is, what's the total intake for the batch? And I think I answered that a little earlier, no precise number, but higher than earlier, maybe around 40. The other part is the program AICTE approved? So to the best of my knowledge, this program doesn't require an AICTE approval as such, because it is, all IIMs are created under an Act of Parliament. Right? So there is an IIM Act. And IIMs are able to offer their own degrees. Okay, so it is not as if we have to be accredited by AICTE or something. But these are totally, these are accepted by all universities and companies in India. Okay. The next question from Manu is there any cutoff in GMAT and GRE scores? And the answer there is, look, we look at your application as an overall package, so to speak. Okay? So it's your profile, it's your experience so far. It is your GMAT or GRE score also. It is your academic track record beyond this. It is the outcome of the interaction we may have with shortlisted candidates, which is an interview process. So all of this goes into deciding on whether to make you an offer or not. So it's not as if there is a very precise cutoff saying below a certain score we would not consider you. But yes, your GMAT GRE score will matter. It will have a weightage, but no very no precise cutoffs. In fact, we believe that there could be many candidates who may have a somewhat low GRE or GMAT score, but who might be exceptionally good in other ways. And we make allowances for that. A question from Dhruv on what is the benefit of doing dual degree course over the entire program at IIM Udaipur. Right. So the way we look at these two programs, so like Koshika mentioned a short while back, in terms of academic rigor and content, right, these are going to be fairly similar. Okay, you would have a very rigorous program in IIM Udaipur as well as in the IIM Udaipur plus Granat option. The difference really, as I see it, is that going to Purdue would give you that extended exposure to a global setting. Right, it's not a short trip. It's a whole semester that you spend in a different academic environment, in a different cultural environment. And that has a huge learning value as well. So that really would be the difference and the benefit of doing the dual degree program. And if that is something that you're looking for, then that's the option you may want to consider. Koshika herself has done the option one. We didn't have an option two at that time. Would you want to share any of your experiences?
Sure. So essentially what happens is that when you're in Purdue, so what will happen is something that you're really learning is not just cross team collaboration, you know, which is you're also learning cross geography collaboration, if I can say that. So when you say cross geography, people are from different cultures, different backgrounds, they have different perspectives, and you have to work with everybody. So that's the biggest advantage that you get when you go there, because though you will be in India and you will get any institute, you know, not just Udaipur. If you're here in India and you're studying 100% in India, so what happens is we are coming from the same culture. We talk the same language, right? So that's the biggest value add that you get. And from that exposure that you get there, and it's a very long time. It's a 5-month time frame, which means you have two sets of exams you cover there. How are the faculties teaching? And overall, as a candidate, you get very well groomed to work in companies that have cross geography locations. You can very easily connect and relate to people in that case. So that's the biggest, one of the really nice advantages that you have when you go to Purdue.
Thanks. Right. So the next question again from Manu is this degree an MBA or an ex-MBA? Okay. So the degree that you would be given is an MBA in global supply chain management. Okay. That would be what it's called. But your supplementary question to that is, can we do a PhD after getting this MBA? Now, see, each institute which offers a PhD, right, each university has its own criteria. There are places where you can do your PhD after doing a 4-year degree, right? If you have an engineering degree, you can start doing your PhD. There are institutes, universities which permit that. So it's a little difficult for me to say whether you can do a PhD after getting this MBA or not. But otherwise, we would expect that this would be considered equivalent to an MBA by... it is an MBA and it is offered by an Indian Institute of Management. But nevertheless, I would request you to drop in a mail to our admissions office so that we can look into this a little more and give you a precise answer to this. We have had students from here who have applied to PhD programs even abroad. So I'm reasonably certain it should be okay with many universities. But like I said, each university has its own standards and criteria. Okay, an anonymous attendee question. I have a master's in applied physics and I have been working in the education field at a government institute for 48 months. Am I eligible to apply? Absolutely. If you have 48 months of full-time kind of work experience, it's not an internship kind of situation. It's a job that you've been doing for 48 months. I'm guessing that since it's been 48 months, it's a regular job in education. So yes, you are eligible to apply. Is TOEFL also required? Yes, if for the Purdue option, which is option one, TOEFL or IELTS, these are the you need to take those exams. Right. Question from Ravi Kumar. Can my profile fit for this program? BTech Electrical, 7 years of work ex in core electrical sector and with PSU. Can I apply and submit my GMAT score at a later stage? Profile, yes. And like I said, you have more than 3 years of experience. This is quite the kind of profile that many of our students would have had, engineering degree with so much work experience in. Profile, I really don't see an issue here. You're totally eligible. You need to submit a valid GMAT score at the time of application. It cannot be subsequently. In case you believe you may not be ready in this cycle, we are going to have one more admission cycle after this one. So maybe you want to wait till then. But you will need to submit a valid GMAT score. Question from Prashant, is it possible to join through CAT score? No, it's not. GMAT or GRE are the options. That's really the path to this. There's a question on what would be the minimum GMAT score. I think I answered this earlier. There's no specific cutoff GMAT score that we have. So, question from Raghavan, I'm from science background, am I eligible? Absolutely, so long as you have completed 15 months or 15 years or 16 years of experience depending on option 2 or option 1, if you have that education, and if you have 3 years of work experience, you are eligible to apply. Okay, I'm a deck officer in the Merchant Navy. I have experience of about 7 years. Do I fit in such a course as I have no corporate background? Short answer from me, but Koshika, if you want to add anything to that, please do. Short answer is yes, you are eligible. And this is a kind of profile which we would often see. So you need not have worked in a corporate setup, so to speak, right? So long as you have worked, you have the experience of working with people, with teams. Those are the kind of things that we are looking for, right? Because you would be in a good position then to appreciate the inputs that you would get in this program. Koshika, would you?
I agree. See, when it comes to management courses are essentially about your overall personality, how you handle situations, how can you manage situations. So, having a Merchant Navy background will have its own advantages, if you look at it. So there's no, you should not have any qualms about that I have a different background and will I be able to, how good it or how beneficial will it be for me coming into a corporate background. So quick example, short example, if you look at Army officers, so there are so many Army officers who actually, even if they don't take an MBA program, because, they obviously have a much longer service, 20 years, 25 years, but they fare extremely well in the corporate world, because they have their own set of experiences and advantages that they've gained over time.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have a variety of backgrounds from which students have come for this program. Yes, more than half of them tend to be engineers, perhaps even a little more. But there are people with background in science, marine engineering, merchant navy. We've had people with experience, a background in medicine who have joined this program and benefited from that because they want to make a career in the healthcare management space. And supply chain management is a valuable thing there as well. Right? So you have a variety of experiences background can work. Another question from Kalyan. I have 3 years of experience in SCM. without degree I want to pursue, am I eligible? Kalyan, the question is not entirely clear to me, but if you have 15 or 16 years of education, as the case may be, and you have 3 years of work experience, absolutely you are eligible. Okay, so and if you have experience in supply chain management, you would, you know, that would enrich the class even more, because you would be able to bring your own perspective to that. Question from Ayush, is there any scholarship provided by the institute for this course? Ayush, I'm afraid that at this stage we do not, the institute does not offer any scholarships for this program. But like for our every program of ours, for this one as well, there are a lot of leading banks which provide funding support. They would be willing to give you loans for this program. So, but scholarship, no. Question for Aditya. Can this course help to change, shift careers in data analysis and data science job domain? I think we have the perfect person to answer that right here. Yeah, Koshika, I think you should be taking.
Absolutely. It goes without saying, especially because what you, the curriculum, if you look at the curriculum and the course academic structure, we have a lot of we do take care, the college takes care of the fact that analytics and analysis is taken care of as part of the course structure. And most of my batchmates, not just me, most of us easily transitioned into companies which were data science driven companies or analytics companies. So yes, that is a very easy transition.
Right. Yeah. And I think almost every year a few students go into the those kind of roles.
Especially if there's so much of AI and machine learning, every company who's doing a little bit of technology wants to move that on that front as much as they can. So, yes.
Question from Avijit. I have 10 years of experience, 5 years in entrepreneurship, 5 years of corporate experience. Is this program suitable for me? All right. So two parts to it. First, eligibility, Avijit, I'm sure it's clear to you that you are eligible, right? About is it suitable for you? Now the point is, you have experience in entrepreneurship and corporate experience. I'm not sure what the nature of that is, but if you are interested in supply chain management and careers based on that, then yes, the program is suitable for you. Okay. But with someone who has, let's say, 10 years of experience, one thing that you would need to think about is how much are you going to build on what you've already done? And therefore, how valuable will this program be to you? You'll have to, you haven't given me those specific details of what you're experience has been in and what you have been an entrepreneur and things like that. But you will have to, and I would strongly suggest that you should look at that. Okay, that whether that experience which you have will get added to by this program rather than it being two totally divergent things. You have 10 years of some kind of experience, but now you start doing global supply chain management. That's one. The other is for someone with your kind of experience, you would also have to look at whether the program will add value to you from one in terms of learning and two in terms of the career opportunities it opens up for you, and even monetarily whether it will make sense for you. Okay. So for that, I would strongly recommend that you look at our website. We have a placement report, which is proper audited placement report based on IPRS standards. So it's audited. So these are fairly reliable numbers. And that will give you an idea of the kind of jobs that people from here have, the kind of careers they have taken up, the kind of compensation they have received, at least at the time of leaving the program. I think you should be looking at all that to decide on suitability. Koshika, anything to add on that?
I think what you covered it all, sir.
Thanks. But at the same time, Abhijit, we have had people with your kind of profile, 10 years of experience and even more. So, but it's a call that you will have to take. From our end, when we, you know, in case you do apply and we call you for an interview, we will try to assess for ourselves whether as an institute, as a program, this will add value to you. And so we'll also take that view. You should also be taking that view. Question from Mayur again. Again, I'm looking for a transformation from sea to land. I'll be entering a never experienced corporate job, very different from job at ship. Does the IIMU GSCM program provide internship opportunities? Mayur, no, this program, actually we've restructured it from this year, but no, given that it's a 12-month program, it would not offer internship. There is no summer internship, or at least not an extended summer internship program. But what you will get is exposure to companies. Okay, and the corporate sector. You may get to do projects which require you to interact with corporates. So that kind of exposure, you will keep meeting people here who come from the corporate sector.
Yeah.
You will keep, you know, you probably work on various activities here which give you that exposure. But, you know, an extended internship is not part of this program. I think even in Purdue, you work with companies there, right, Koshika?
Yeah, we do. So you can take up short little projects when you go to Purdue. That's outside the curriculum. It totally depends on the student's interest and how much do you want to take it forward. So there are short little projects you can associate with faculty and help them on those projects. So that's another, that now 5 months that you're there, you can do at least multiple projects. Totally depends on you as an individual.
And Mayur, yes, I know initially it looks daunting making this shift, and yes, it is a big decision, but there are many successful cases. I mean, almost every person who comes in here successfully navigates that that shift. Question on want to do the IIM Udaipur masters and GMAT, I think it's a GRE score of 289. Can I apply? Yes, of course you can apply. Like I said a little earlier in response to a different question, we'll be looking at your application in its totality. The GRE score will be part of that. But definitely you can apply. Yes. Question from Tushar, are there scholarship options? I answered this a little earlier. I'll just quickly repeat that. No, there is no scholarship that the institute offers, but loans from banks are quite easily available. There's one more question on scholarship, so it's the same. Question from Raghavan, is coding experience a prerequisite? No, absolutely not. There's no expectation that you know coding. If you have it, it is, you know, it might just bring value to the classroom, to your you often work in groups on various projects, and if you have something additional that you bring to the table, that's valuable. But if you don't have it, it doesn't it's really not a prerequisite or anything like that. Question on from Manu, BE MTech, 10 years of work ex in operations, sales and marketing, am I eligible? Yes, absolutely you're eligible. What kind of job and package can I expect? I'll briefly tell you, and Koshika could add after that, there's a variety of roles that people get into. Like I said, you should look at our replacement report, that will give you some idea. There are people who go into the manufacturing sector. There are people who may go into the retail sector. Online retail is a big thing now, and that's a space where supply chain management is very valuable. People who get into data science, analytics kind of roles, people who go into consulting kind of roles. So all of these are possibilities. So it's fairly wide question.
Absolutely. So essentially, when we say if you pick up an example of consulting, so even if you have experience in operations, sales and marketing, essentially you can be part of that consulting division that's catering to operations and sales. Similarly, when we say, so there is no direct link, I would say, as to what you've done versus what you want to do. You can always easily make a switch. You want to continue with what you did and add value and have the course add value and continue to get back to the same domain. That's a total choice that you have.
Given that you have 10 years of experience, it seems like it would make sense for you to try and leverage that experience.
I
would say that a lot more for you than someone who comes with 3 years of experience. Right? For you, you should probably try and use that.
Can't agree more with you, sir, on this one. Yeah.
Manishankar, for the IIM exclusive option, option two, would placements be taking along the same time as option one? They would be going on together. It's not as if there's a separate placement track for option one and a separate placement track for option two. No, it would happen together. And all the same opportunities, at least from an institute perspective, we are not going to be discriminating one way or the other, right? So it's all open to you. There is a placement office which supports this, but placements, the whole getting companies onto the campus and all that, a lot of the effort is actually put in by the students themselves. It's not that there's someone sitting here who it's not places you. Okay? It'll happen together. Ravi Kumar, what's the average GMAT score of the present class? Any specific recruiter for this specialized program offered only by IIM Udaipur? The average GMAT score, I do not have a precise number, but I think it would be in the region of 650 or so. Yeah. It's somewhere around there, but there is a range around it, both ways. In terms of specific recruiters, have a good number of companies. For instance, I don't know, with no particular reason, I'm just naming a few. Right, it's not in any particular order. Accenture, Flipkart, Cummins India,
Amazon.
Amazon. Have people who go on to Dell, this IntegriChain. Right. And so these are all the kind of roles that people are in. Any other names? I think you should look up the list which is there on the website. I'm not directly engaged with that process, but there's some...
The ones that you mentioned, sir, are recruiters at our campus for the course. They've been coming here year after year. Yeah. The ones that you mentioned here.
There's Reliance Jio, there's Vodafone, I think it comes. So there's a fairly wide range. But hopefully this gives you a flavor that it's across sectors that we get recruiters. Please do go through the brochure which is on the website. Mohit, can a one-year MBA be used for a career change from different industry and function? I'm currently in telecom.
I will take this one. Sorry.
Yeah, wonderful.
We have an exam. So since I'm from the first batch, we had somebody with our batch who was from telecom. So I'm just giving an example because it's a live example. Mm-hmm. So he was from telecom, did the course with us. With the Udaipur, the GSCM program, moved into manufacturing, predominantly garment manufacturing, in some shape or form. He was with consulting. He was with Accenture for a while. Then from that, moved into retail. So essentially, if you look at it, in the past 6 years, he was able to switch three different industries and functions. But yes, when you look at functions specifically, I'm saying, because post-MBA, I would want to still say it is related to supply chain and operations. And as you grow in the career and go towards the C-suite. But before that, he was definitely not in supply chain. So he transitioned from telecom and is now currently in retail and doing extremely well. So, yes.
Yes. And I recall at least one case of a person who went from here into supply chain in telecom. So,
and for me as well, I started for I was essentially part of the fashion industry, and right now I'm in IT. So,
okay.
No relationship at all.
So, yes, a lot of people actually do take up this program a few years into their career because they're looking to change the sphere of operations, make a career change. And there are those who say that you want to continue in the same industry but in different kinds of roles. So both ways, this helps quite well. The question on academics are poor, but I have work experience of 5.5 years in industry. Am I eligible? Yes, you're eligible, so long as you have those 16 years of or 15 years of experience of education and you have those degrees. Now, if you haven't completed your degrees, then that's a problem. But if you have completed that, you are eligible. And like I said, we look at your application in its entirety. It's possible that your academics were not very strong, but you may more than make up for that in other ways with respect to your experience or your profile otherwise, or your drive, your enthusiasm. All of these are things which matter. How much score for GRE and TOEFL is suitable for this program, Akshay? I really won't be able to tell you a number on this. Like I said, there is no specific cutoff for the program. Right? But yes, since you mentioned TOEFL also, I would like to let you know that the admission, at least for option one, the admission process is IIMU Udaipur makes, we process your application, we decide whether we want to interview you or not, and then after the interview, we would decide on whether to make you an offer or not. But thereafter, you would have to apply to Purdue separately, and you would have to go through the Purdue admission process also. So both of these have to happen in case of option one. So this is a follow-up to the earlier question where the person said the academics are poor, but I have international exposure in various countries. Now, wonderful. So that's the kind of thing that may help you make up for not having a great academic track record. What is the fee difference we can expect if we choose option one? I'm afraid I do not immediately have precise numbers, but you should be looking at our website. All these details are mentioned there. If I remember right, the fee is in, if you take option two, the fee is in the region of around 17 lakhs, including living expenses and so on. Broadly, that's, but please do check the website. But if you opt for option one, there is a separate, the fee that IIMU Udaipur would charge would be a little less, but then Purdue would be charging you a fee, and overall it would cost significantly higher than option two. The details are available on the website, so Dhruv, would request you to check that. So Mayur, who is from the Merchant Navy, has asked a question on can I get an opportunity to connect with alumni from the Merchant Navy? Can you get me in touch with a few? Please do drop in a line to the admissions office. We will try and connect you with someone who is either a student here now or who's an alumni from this area. Please do drop in a line. The email address is on the website. Otherwise, it's next question from Dhruv. Since there are no internship programs at IIMU Udaipur, what are the chances of campus placements? especially for a person like me who's trying to switch career from one place to another. So I do not think it's going to very strong really affect your chances of campus placement because you didn't go through any because the program doesn't have an internship module. I really do not see a linkage. Koshika, do you see any?
There isn't one. Unless and until, Dhruv, you're looking at that, you know what, if I did an internship with X company, I will get a pre-placement offer. Then it's a totally different scenario that you're talking about. But otherwise, internships and the campus placements are pretty much delinked, if you look at it. We have enough number of companies on the campus that come over and that you can apply to.
So, yeah, no, I don't think this is going to make too much of a difference. Can't link it at all.
Yeah.
Okay, question from Ravi Kumar. Does a recruiter decide the package based on previous round package in any B school? What if I don't want to display my current package? Okay, so this is a tough one. I really, how does a recruiter decide what to offer you? It's a discussion that an applicant has with the recruiter. Right. Among other things, they may look at what is it that you were last drawing. And they would look at what is the value that you bring to the company. They would look at whether there are others like you who are available for them. All of these factors are going to matter. But is there anything...
Pretty much. So when companies come to campus, what happens is you definitely have most cases you have job descriptions available, and there's a salary bracket or a band that they're looking for depending on the role. So when you're applying for that role, you know what is the bracket that you're applying to from a package perspective. That's one of the pointers that you can keep in mind. And the other thing is that, let's say you take that interview when you're selected and you're in subsequent rounds. Again, it purely depends on the skills that you display to the recruiter. And if those skills are something that the recruiter is looking for. So it doesn't mean that if there's a band given or, you know, shared with you earlier that they're looking to hire in this bracket for this role, they can definitely, it all depends, and you can actually negotiate for more. So if there have been cases where people have been able to negotiate more, that happens quite often.
Next one's an interesting one. Are students in the course allowed to participate in B-school competitions? Yes, absolutely. You are in a B-school and you can participate in B-school competitions, including those which IIMU Udaipur students themselves organize. It just so happens that, with option one, since you spent 5 months of your time in Purdue, so you may not, you will have that much less of an opportunity to participate in India because you're not going to be in India. But I think a lot of people who go to Purdue participate in competitions there as well. Have anything to say on that?
Yes, we do. And when you are in Purdue is a very good academy. It's known well for supply chains and supply chain operations. So the folks that you'll be around, considering you're there in that country in the US, you actually get to go and participate in business competitions that are organized by Chicago Booth, that are organized by, obviously there's a distance and time that you keep in mind as a student, but most every year after year, people who go there take the opportunity to go ahead and participate in these different B-school competitions, which are known for, and that's a great, great value add as well. So not just Chicago Booth, there's a list. That's a never-ending list, actually.
And at least I'm quite proud to say that our students have had a very good track record when they participate over there. Yes. The question on, can I defer my admission from 2020 to 2021? As of now, we do not have a deferred admission scheme for this program. But if you have any particular reason that you would like to do this, you could drop us a mail. We'll have a look at that. But I really cannot assure anything on this because we do not have a formal deferred admission program. But please do drop us a line. Question from Sai. Can we get a profile feedback if it is rejected in round one? not entirely sure I understand, but I think what you're saying is if you are not shortlisted for the interview, would you get to know what it is about? I know. So we do not do that. We look at your application in its entirety and take a view. So it's quite difficult to respond specifically on to each individual on why they were not shortlisted. That's not a practice that we are following as of now. Anonymous, what is option one total fees? I'm really sorry, but I do not have the number on my fingertips. It is, all details are given on our website. But if that is not clear to you, please do drop a line to our admissions office. We'll respond within a day. Okay, we're coming close to end of time, but maybe probably taking most of the questions. But okay, so feedback saying that if we get profile feedback, it would be good for us to develop our profile and apply again in round two. Can we get profile feedback if we contact admissions team separately? Like I said, so far it's not been a practice that we followed, but it's an interesting suggestion. I would not be in a position to immediately tell you whether it can be done or not. I'm noting that, and maybe you could also drop a mail to the admissions office. We will get back to you on this with more clarity if we have it. And is there any fixed ratio of students opting for option one and option two? No, not really. We have not thought of any specific ratio. We, like I said, we are looking at more students than we've had in the past, but we are not saying that we will try and maintain any ratio. There would be some considerations based on which Purdue, for instance, if suddenly 100 people want to go for the Purdue option, there may be limitations on that. But otherwise, we do not have any ratio. In your interest, which option do you want to choose or apply for is more important than or maintaining any ratio. So, since we are approaching 8:30, we'll and I think we have taken most of the questions. In case there's anything still remaining, please do drop a line to our admissions office. The details are available on the website. Like I mentioned a couple of times, would strongly recommend that you go through the website, including the placement report, so that you understand what kind of career opportunities this could open up. You should take an informed decision on before you decide to apply, and definitely before you decide to accept an offer from us. Koshika, would you have any concluding remarks? Sorry, you're on mute, I think.
Oh, sorry about that. Thank you. So all the questions were interesting, and I hope that we were able to answer most of your queries and clarifications that you wanted, and you have enough information that you want at this point in time from us. Please ensure you've seen the website. It'll give you further clarity on the fee structure, the timings, and everything, things of that nature. One last comment maybe on Purdue. Because there was a question that was asked that what is a Purdue advantage. So one thing that I can definitely add as a closing comment is that I work for a company that's essentially, we are headquartered in the US, but I'm employed by the India office. So every time I'm in India, it's IIMU that matters. So pretty much. But each time I visit my US office, my CEO is talking to me about, what you went to Purdue. So you must be knowing this. So that makes a lot of difference. So I don't have to tell them I went to Purdue. They pretty much just know. And there are a lot of things that come as a given after that. So, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's true. Because these days, more and more, even if you're working in India, you're constantly interacting with people from across the world, and that's why it's called the program in global supply chain management.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
So thank you everyone for joining. It was, you know, and for your active participation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.